So that is why I will now ask the cameraman to hand me this cup, the halftime cup. This is the first time we are presenting the halftime cup because we are not sure they will actually win. But it is a cup that we can celebrate for now. Thank you, Mr. Director. As you can see how beautiful this cup is, I'm not sure that they will enjoy it as much as I enjoy holding it. This is the halftime cup, and this goes to you, the Boston Celtics, for playing well and continuing to impress and surprise people. I hope that you go on to do great things for the rest of the season.
Hello, welcome back to this week's episode of Halftime with myself, Naranda Brown, and my co-host, Darius Burris. This week, we'll be discussing, first and foremost, Tottenham Hotspur sacking Mauricio Pochettino. What are our reactions? Did he deserve to be sacked? The question that still looms in the air, and who will be the prospects to take that so coveted job at Tottenham for the years to come? Darius, first of all, I'll take your reaction on that. Was it expected? Are you surprised by this sacking? And do you think he deserved what he got?
Well, good evening, Mr. Brown, and good evening, everyone. My take on the Tottenham sacking, I want to bring this to your attention. If you can pick up this is not exactly... We have to improvise today. We don't have a sack of potatoes, but we have... What you put potatoes in, a netting or something like that. We'll have to put Mauricio Pochettino inside here because he was sacked, terminated, removed, or as Tottenham happily put it, relieved of his duties today. Now, I can be honest, no one saw, I didn't see coming. I certainly did not.
I was expecting Unai Emery first, to be honest.
Yes, he was actually leading this race for me. You know, they were saying Ole, but I think Unai was at the top of the list the last few weeks because of what was going on with Arsenal. In fact, fake news came out that he was actually sacked, I think, about last week. I think that was the case. It was fake news. But I do not believe Pochettino was sacked. I'll tell you why. He had some issues in the dressing room, but notwithstanding that, I don't feel like he was backed fully by the club financially. There was a season, I think it was last season, that he didn't spend a cent in the transfer window. He went into the season with the same players he had. And I'm made to understand that this season, he tried to sell some players who made it pretty clear that they wanted to leave the club. And the club, I guess the hierarchy, said, no, you are not selling anybody. And as such, couldn't sell. And they said, I think they told him, you can't buy if you don't sell. So you put the guy between a rock and a hard place. So I don't think it was fair to Pochettino at all. I don't think so. I'm pretty disappointed because earlier in the season I would have mentioned that I love how Tottenham was playing when they were in full flight, when Pochettino's system was working and all the parts were moving and everybody was healthy and fit. They used to play some scintillating football.
I agree.
Now with him being sacked, I'm not certain who would come after, but that is a topic that we will elaborate on further. But as of right now, I don't think he deserved to be sacked because let us look at the timeline. In junior and Champions League final. Now in November, languishing in 14th place, of course. Not totally his fault as there was a super bright in the dressing room. But languishing in 14th place and then sacked during the international break. Wow, things really changed pretty quickly in football. Don't you agree, Mr.
Brown? I totally agree. But we have to bear into mind as well that football is a results game, especially in the English Premier League. The teams, the hierarchy, they crave results, and if the results aren't going their way, then they tend to take action extremely swiftly. In the case of Mauricio Pochettino, I think he and the club had an agreement. He knew what he was getting into. Because Tottenham has never been the type of club to go out and spend the big bucks without any coming in. And we saw...
Well, I agree, but still, wow, we could have given him like... Well, they gave him Ndombele this last season, but who did he get?
Yeah, but who did they sell? Who did they sell?
Didn't sell anybody.
Exactly. So usually what they do, they sell players and then they use the funds generated from these sales to reinvest into other players. We saw with the sale of Gareth Bale, we saw with the sale of Luka Modric, they just reinvested those monies back into players coming into the squad. But back to the results aspect of it, Tottenham has won 25% of their games this season.
They
No,
have lost 18 games since in 2019 as well.
the
That's a stat I would mention in that.
Exactly, and we're the other day we spoke about Chelsea and their defense and Tottenham Hotspur. They have world class defenders. They have Toby Alderweireld. They have what's his Ver Jan Vertonghen. They have the youngster and Sanchez, who is really good as well in my book. He's just a bit inexperienced and probably needs to be groomed a little bit more. But they've shipped 17 goals, and that's
Wow.
the same as Chelsea. So. And
That's this season, 17 goals.
that's this season. So they've shipped 17 goals and they've scored 18 goals.
Including the Bayern Munich
Uh,
17
no,
goals
no,
win that they got.
no, no. That th this is solely the English
Wow.
Premier League. So
I didn't know when them goals passed.
if I should go into that Bayern Munich situation, it will
But
be
yeah.
the numbers will be a little bit more. But
Yeah.
as I said, it's the results aren't reflecting well for Mauricio Pochettino. And I think, in addition to the situation that they had back of house, it may have contributed to him being relieved of their du of his duties.
Mr.
I
Brown,
agree with what you
quick
were saying as
question.
well. Yeah, go
Do
ahead.
you not think he had enough, I guess, to allow him more time? I think he did enough for the club in the time he was there, the 5 year spell, where I think he finished in the top four every year since he was there.
I.
Well, of course, no, he's not in the top four, and he carried them to a Champions League final. Don't you think he had enough in the tank for them to say, well, all right, let's give him enough time to right the ship? What do you think about that?
Maybe, but at the end of the day, we know that clubs are selfish and they are extremely ungrateful as well. Let me put it that way.
Very ungrateful.
They are very ungrateful because you might have done the world for them, but once the results aren't going your way, then that's it. And we saw it a few years ago with Roberto Di Matteo as well at Chelsea. He came in as interim,
Yeah,
and
won the Champions League and then sacked probably what, 6 months after, is that
there
long?
you go. So, and he
Really?
won the Champions League, mind you. So this is not a Mauricio Pochettino who went to the Champions League final. This guy lifted the Champions League for Chelsea Football Club, a club that has spent millions of dollars. Since Roman Abramovich came over, it has seen so many top-class managers that I myself lost count. And this guy came in with little experience, and he was the one who lifted the Champions League for the clubs. And he was sacked a few months later. So I think no one is exempt when it comes to sacking because results are what gets a club paid. Results are what drives fans to come out on the weekends. And for midweek games. So it's unfortunate for Mauricio Pochettino considering where he took the club. Tottenham, they have never been considered serious contenders. I think since he came in, I'm not gonna say they're no
I don't think
contenders.
they were considered serious
That,
contenders, but they were there or
yeah,
thereabouts
that's what I'm
in
getting
the
at now.
last
Yeah,
years.
that's
They
what I'm
have
getting
been
at.
there.
Yeah, and we have been taking them a little bit more seriously since he has
Yes,
taken
that's
over.
correct. I
Yeah,
agree with that.
so. It's not a case where once you're going up against Tottenham, you know, okay, it's 3 points in the bag, or you know that, okay, they're a walkover when it comes to the bigger guys. A lot of bigger teams have been taking them a little bit more seriously since Mauricio Pochettino came. And it's unfortunate, but it is the way it is. And they'll just have to move on from it. It is a sport, it's
Mr.
what they
Brown,
signed up for.
where you think Pochettino will end up?
Ah.
If I could pick your brain a little bit, where you think you'll end up for him?
Well, Pochettino,
You know Real Madrid was suiting him pretty hard, and they were batting their eyelids at him.
and
He was missing.
I know he must be like he must be extremely disappointed in himself. No,
He should have taken that job in August.
that's what he'll be saying to himself.
Is the
But
truth?
because Zidane is not doing too bad now, so maybe.
I think he would still end up there.
Maybe in
I really do.
maybe in a year or two, but not as of now. Not
Do you
as
think
of
he
now.
goes on to the unemployment line?
Well, he's a good manager, so it's hard. It will be hard for him to be out of a job for very long, because we have to consider as well, it's not a manager like a Jose Mourinho, who is used to coaching high-profile teams. We have to remember, this guy was coaching Espanyol. He went to Southampton as well. So I think he wouldn't mind coaching a lesser caliber team than Tottenham, for the time being at least, if he still wants to be working. Maybe he wants to sit out the rest of the season. Who knows? Until the ideal job comes his way. But maybe PSG will be in the long run. Who knows?
Yeah, I would think so. But what do you think dictated this decision? You said results recently, of course. But why is it it took so long? Because we are during the international break.
And
their most recent result, I don't think they lost that game.
No, they drew the last game leading into the international round.
That was against Sheffield, was it against Sheffield?
Yeah, I think it was. It was the same one with the offside call.
With the toenail offside.
Yeah.
Isn't that they sat there and they said we would have to, I guess, reassess during the international break, or is it that this was a knee-jerk reaction because we are only 2 months into the season? Is it that they could not somehow contrive to say, let's wait till January, the transfer window strengthen, or is it that they decided to pull the trigger because they just think that Pochettino would have never brought the side back to where they will or where they will head in? I don't know.
But funny enough, the international break is basically concluded now.
It's basically concluded. Yeah.
Yeah. So usually when teams are sacking managers in the international break, they sack them the first week. So when the teams go out like after the final game leading into the international break, so they sack them in that week, and then they use the remaining 5 or 6 days to try and do some business to get someone else in to take over for that person.
At least he could work with the players a little bit before the first game, I guess, of his tenure as coach.
Precisely my point.
Strange to me.
I think they had a meeting today. I think they had a meeting and it just didn't turn out. They couldn't agree amicably on something that was suitable for both parties, and that's what yielded the result that we saw. So I won't dwell too much on that though, because it already passed, and we know that it's a part of it. So we'll move on to the forward thinking, and I'll pose a question to you now. Who do you think are the best candidates to take over from Mr. Pochettino?
All right, before I give you best candidates, I'll give you what the reports are saying. There is word, got this from Sky Sports, that Mourinho is in talks with Tottenham as we speak, and they are hoping that a deal is hammered out tonight. Mourinho divides opinion. I was never a fan of Mourinho. I was never a fan of his style of football. He coached Chelsea, he coached Manchester United, he coached Real Madrid, coached a host of big clubs, as we know. But I will go with the stint he had in Manchester United in particular here, because that's close to my heart. He divides the dressing room because of, I'm guessing, the way he would, not only the way he plays football, but the way he, I guess, he causes a lot of reaction with the fans and with the players, and it's not always positive. So I am not sure, given what occurred in Tottenham earlier this year with the whole bust up between the players, Mourinho is the best figure to come in and probably, you know, put his hand around everybody and said, "Right, we're together now. I'm here now as the new coach." I don't think he has that ability to bring harmony and unity to that dressing room, given all that went on this year. So I wouldn't have him as the best candidate, but I guess they probably, if reports are true, they see it a different way. To me, I would think Allegri could come in. We have a few coaches that are out of a job, but Allegri, I think he would be a good coach for Tottenham. Also, I'm going to toss in a name there that will cause some controversy. Arsene Wenger. You see, Arsene Wenger plays attacking football. And I think Tottenham is known for attacking football. I see you laughing at me, Mr. Brown.
That.
I threw that there because I'm trying to cause some worries to the Arsenal fans.
I'm 100% sure that's not gonna happen.
Those two clubs. He would not leave Arsenal and head right across the road stadium to stick it to Arsenal, as they would say, because he probably left on not under the best circumstances. Everyone wasn't pleased with him. But as of right now, if I was in the head of Daniel Levy, I would stay clear of Mourinho and I will go for Allegri. That's my pick. But of course, there's a reason I'm sitting here and not Daniel Levy sitting where he's sitting.
Okay. Fair enough, and fully understandable considering that last name you put in the bracket. But with the Mourinho situation as well, I'll take it a step further. Do you think Jose Mourinho could operate with that Tottenham policy? Because Tottenham are not exactly, and Mauricio Pochettino has basically been operating on scraps for the past few seasons, and Mourinho.
Scraps is the loading bread line. The man was impoverished.
And we all know Mourinho likes to spend big. He goes out, he opens the wallet, and he gets what he wants. And if he doesn't get what he wants, then
he goes in the media and he creates a scene. He did it at Manchester United. He did it at Chelsea in his final year.
And
I don't know why they would believe you do something different.
Right. So issues will start there. And Tottenham has never been, as I led with at the beginning of our discussion, they've never been the team to spend a lot of money. So if they're considering Jose Mourinho, they have to consider opening a new bank account or taking out some loans or something, because he's high maintenance and he'll be getting in players that are high maintenance as well. So,
but do you think they will write that into his contract? No, I would think he would negotiate that, all right. If I am coming to your club to manage, I have terms, and these are my terms. His terms may include those types of things, because you would have seen he fell out with management at his last two places of employment because of lack of funding, as all, not giving him what he wants, as you would see in the financial, in the transfer market. So he probably will now take front and say, hey, I need probably 3 or 4 players, and I would need about $300 million or $350 million to start building that team in my image and likeness. If not, I would quit, and I guess he would try to write in, I guess, getting paid a hefty severance fee, because he normally does it whenever he decides to leave that club.
Yeah. Do you think here's what I think. I'm not sure what to say about what you just said. However, this is what I'm thinking. Previously, Tottenham were thinking long term. However, they've arrived at a conclusion now that they need to win something, and to win something fast. So I think they're willing, if they should sign Jose Mourinho, I think they'd be willing to throw that long-term mindset.
Plan out the window.
Exactly, and just try
it. They're trying to win now?
They want to win something, because it has been too long. They haven't won. They have never won the Premier League. They
have, realistically, right now, what do you think they can
do? I think Jose Mourinho with this Tottenham squad can win trophies with this Tottenham squad. With the current crop of players, they have one of the top strikers in
playing his style of football.
He has a perfect players at Tottenham right now to carry out his style of play.
To play anti-football?
Right, because he has Heung-min Son. He's fast, he's direct. He has Harry Kane, fast, direct. He has Dele Alli, fast, direct. Lucas Moura, the same thing. And when you check the defense line, he has strong physical players who are willing to stay there and to get physical.
The question you have to ask, as much as these attackers are fast and direct, do you think they are willing to die, quote-unquote, for Mourinho?
Well,
he expects his attacking players to track back him.
Well, if you want
the dirty side of the job as well.
Most of the Tottenham players are doing it now. Most of them are doing it now. So it will just be Mourinho being more direct when it comes to what he needs, and being a more hard-handed manager, because Pochettino was the type of manager who would throw his arms around them or whatnot. Mourinho is not that type of person. He'll let them know when they're messing up, and he's extremely straightforward. So I think it's just for them to arrive at the conclusion that, okay, we're going to win something within this particular time period or time frame, and the players to just rally around him. Because I think this crop of players with Jose Mourinho can win something. because they're really great players. Most of the players in the Tottenham team, they walk into a Liverpool or a Manchester City team. And we have to bear that into consideration, right? I think even the squad on a whole, like, it's thin, but it has great players. That's my take on it.
Well, yeah, I agree with that. They have great players, but as you said, squad depth is an issue. And I think that will be an issue for whoever comes in there as well. And given the fact that it would be a total change in philosophy going forward, remember, they used to press a lot for Pochettino. I'm not sure, Mourinho doesn't employ the press. He concedes the space depending on who is the opponent he's playing, and he plays totally on the counter attack. I know Tottenham would be capable of doing that, but I am not certain that style best suits the players they have.
The players they have now are extremely compact, and we spoke about it a few weeks ago. They close the spaces, especially in the middle of the field, and they're really, really direct when it comes to transition play. So I think Jose Mourinho fits right in. It's just for the agreement with him and the hierarchy. That will be the only issue, because the budget aspect of it, as I said before, when he wants a player, he makes it known. And if it's not going his way, then it's the highway. So.
Well, in all honesty, I give him a year if he's I'm being honest with you. I give him a year in Tottenham under those circumstances with those budgetary restrictions. Yeah, and after that, he gets another
healthy I agree with you so far. They're not doing too bad, but title contenders, title contenders is a stretch, but I'm listening.
Moving on to we are in this segment. We'll be dealing with the NBA now. The NBA season is in full swing, and as you can see, the best are rising to the top. As it currently stands in the West, we know the Lakers are on top, which is what the bookies had from the earlys. They expected the Lakers and the Clippers to be on top of the Western Conference. But we have a surprise as of right now, and that surprise deserves honorable mention. That is what I'm here to do. I am going to introduce five reasons why I believe the Boston Celtics are legit contenders in the Eastern Conference for the whole NBA title. Now, the Boston Celtics currently sit at the top of the Eastern Conference. They have played 13 games, they have won 11, they have lost 2. So I'm going to give you my 5 reasons. I think that deserves some mention because, in all honesty, they lost Kyrie Irving, they lost Al Horford. Those were 2 big pieces in the last season, and everyone said, well, after they have won, we don't expect much from the Celtics. In fact, I will admit it, I didn't expect much. So that is why I will now ask the cameraman to hand me this cup, the halftime cup. This is the first time we are presenting the halftime cup because we are not sure they will actually win, but it is a cup that we can celebrate for now. Thank you, Mr. Director. As you can see how beautiful this cup is, I'm not sure that they will enjoy it as much as I enjoy holding it. This is the halftime cup, and this goes to the Boston Celtics for playing well and continuing to impress and surprise people. I hope that you go on to do great things for the rest of the season. What say you, Mr. Brown?
I think they'll gracefully accept it because not every team will be a champion, but they're currently playing like champions, and they definitely deserve to be recognized for what they've been doing so far this season. I agree with most your pointers. You put forward some valid points. As I said, the only thing or the only concern I have is the energy that they've been showing on the offensive side and throughout the entire court on a whole. I'd really love to see a little bit more of that. Not saying they're not doing well enough, but we've seen an evolution, so to speak, in this team since the departure of Kyrie Irving. So I think it's not far-fetched or too much to ask if they put a little bit more effort into defend.
Defend. I was not going to ask if it's offensive or defensive.
No, into defending.
Offensively, they are giving.
Yeah, offensively, they're okay because the points are being spread throughout the team, and it's not like a Rockets team where you see, okay, James Harden dropping 50.
James
Harden, yeah, so
48 points.
Yeah, so it's not like a team like that, and then probably the closest player to him being 26 or 25, and then everyone else is in single digits. It's not something like that. So it's balanced throughout the team. So even if they decide to double team one player, another player steps up. So it's really good to see, and it's really refreshing to see in the basketball in the NBA this season as well, because in this current era of basketball, there are a lot of players being double teamed, because once players go out against a particular team, they're like, okay, if they're going up against the Bucks, they're trying to stop the players to Giannis as much as possible. Same thing with the Golden State. If Steph Curry is fit, they're trying to get him out, or Clay with Lakers, LeBron, etc. And I could go on all night, but it's good to see them sharing the points throughout the team, and everyone stepping up and pulling their own weight. So hats off to Boston Celtics, and I hope to see you when the end of the season comes.
Hats off to them winning the first halftime cup, and we plan to give out a few more of those as the season progresses, whether football, basketball, or any other sport that I guess people deem that they should receive a cup.
Hopefully we aren't giving that one to Mourinho in a few months.
No, I ain't giving you no cup. Give me a cup of water to drink.
All right, folks. Thanks for tuning in to this week's episode of Halftime. Myself, Norando Brown, and Darius Boris tuning out. Please remember to like, share, subscribe, and leave your comments. So. We really appreciate it. Thanks for the love and support you've shown us throughout the past few weeks as well. Until next time, take care. Halftime TV out.